Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And today's show is brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, motorcycle, RV, whatever it may be. The great people at Purdy Insurance will take care of everything to make sure you're fully insured and also save you money. Yes, you'd like to keep as much, quote, paper as possible. At Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury, and go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf and online at sunburymotors.com. And speaking of paper, because this is one of our favorite sayings, okay? Our favorite saying is always, less work, more paper. Dick Jerardi, DJ, welcome back to the show. Great to have you with us.
Steve, happy to be here when it's 60 degrees in State College on February the 26th. What is going on here? Is the world coming to an end, or what's happening?
I mean, the global warming thing, some elements have worked out better than I thought it would.
Yeah, really. I mean, I'm looking at the mountains. I see a little Tussey Mountain. I see a little snow on the East Coast slopes, but that's about it around here.
That's about it.
And we're going to Iowa City tonight, and it used to be 73 degrees in Iowa City.
How about that?
February. I mean, we've been there where it's minus 30 or feels
exactly.
Like it's 100 degree difference. So, looking forward to that trip.
Building a fire in the room because you had to.
Exactly. What a thing. What a great world it is. So, yeah, and as you said, sometimes global warming works in your favor.
Let's get to something else that's worked in Penn State's favor, and that's how they played last week. Saturday, Dick, what kind of example was that in the win over Indiana of the power of what the three means in modern basketball?
Yeah, Steve, I don't think Penn State really played all that well in comparison to some other games.
Agreed.
And they scored 83 points, so I think that answers the question. And when we had Mike Rhodes on after the game, he said, look, the modern game is free throws and three-point shots. They made 26 free throws and 9 three-pointers. I mean, you can all do the math. That's 53 of the 83, and that's where they won the game because Indiana's kind of a throwback, low post, throw it into the post, score 2x2, and they actually made, I think, 5 more field goals than Penn State.
Yes, 5 more baskets, yep.
And lost by 9, so they didn't make any 3 essentially until the game was over. Penn State made 9, Indiana made 2 like in the last couple of minutes when the game had already been decided. So yeah, I think that tells you a lot about the power of the shot, and this coaching staff obviously understands it. I don't want to say they've recruited to it, because that's really not fair, because they really have a chance to recruit, but they went into the transfer portal thinking about it, got some players specifically that could shoot it, and stayed with some of those players even where they weren't making it, on the theory that the way they were designing this was getting open shots, eventually those shooters would start to make them. And over the last, say, month, Penn State had the 1 3-game winning streak, including a couple on the road in the league, and now has a 2-game winning streak from last week. And a lot of that, not all of it, but a lot of it is because they developed a much better three-point shooting team, and that's a tribute, A, to the shooters, B, the coaching staff, and probably more than anything, Ace Baldwin's just being a maestro and getting the ball to the shooters in the right place at the right time.
If we had a dollar for every time that we said during the course of the season in November, December, the January, that a swing guy you and I said over and over again was Zach Hicks, what have we now seen in the past month that backs up the fact that he is one of the swing guys on this team?
Again, I give the coaching staff A+. A, identifying who they wanted. Zach, of course, was having a nice career at Temple. convincing him that he could fit in nicely, and then more than anything, Steve, staying with him when he couldn't put the ball in the basket. A lot of coaches would have just said, you know what, we've given you every chance, you've started every game, you're shooting under 30%, we just can't do it anymore. But they saw the big picture, and the big picture was, if Zach Hicks could develop into an all-court player, guarding, occasionally getting to the basket or at least mid-range, getting to the free throw line, and those shots started falling, they'd have a potential all-league player. And look, Zach's not going to make all-league this year, but he's been an all-league player for a month. He's been that good. So, yeah, again, that's a tribute to the big picture thinking of the coaching staff. You have a 6'8", three-man who's capable of shooting from range. And as we said from the beginning, Steve has the picture-perfect shooting form. And at some point, that form is going to put the ball's going in the basket. Well, now it's going in the basket. Zach has confidence. He's become a major weapon.
And this is something, when you and I talked to him after the game, you could almost hear the appreciation in his voice that the staff stuck with him.
For sure. I think there was one time on one of the broadcasts I actually said, and it turned out to be wrong, that, man, I don't know, you're showing a lot of patience here. I'm not sure I could show that kind of patience, but they were smarter than me, and they stuck with him. And I remember talking to his dad. I saw his dad at a high school game back in November, and he said, look, just go tell Zach to keep shooting. Of course, I went to the layup lines in the next game. That's what I told him, and he smiled. And he has. And now he's so now he's hunting his shot and not just a three-point shot, because, look, everybody's trying to run him off the line. That's fine. It's hard to run him off the line because he can shoot over you at 6'8". But if they do run him on the line, he can bounce it three or four times, get into that mid-range, pump fake, get fouled. He's getting to the line. Of course, he made the three biggest free throws of the season to win the Illinois game on Wednesday night.
You mentioned Ace Baldwin being the maestro. I mean, you know, he's a ball-dominant point guard. I mean, what has it meant to him to have the freedom to be the ball-dominant point guard, and what has it meant to the other players around him?
Yeah, I mean, you hate to say it, but just the reality is the reality, Steve. You just say it. Kanye Clary not being there, and this is not a knock on Kanye at all, it's really addition by subtraction, because the floor was a little too crowded with both of them out there. They're both incredibly skilled, but they both need the ball to be effective. And there's only one ball and two guys, so a lot of times the floor was a little too crowded with them. Kanye is a better, just straight out a scorer, even than Ace is, but he doesn't see the floor like Ace did. So once Kanye got hurt, we saw what it looked like with Ace out there all the time. And, you know, look, that may have happened anyway. We'll never know now. And then there were other things that happened that, you know, you and I are not privy to is exactly what happened. And Kanye is no longer with the team. And as we said on the broadcast Saturday, you know, hopefully he finds a really good spot for him, and he's happy, and he gets to play a couple more years of college hoops. But it turns out that this team is more effective with just the one small left-handed point guard out there. And I don't think it's any mystery to anybody. All you got to do is watch the game. So I think that's part of it, that Ace has been free. He's out there all the time. And when he's out there, he is completely in charge rather than in charge some of the time. I think all that has helped him. And it's also helped the other guys because, you know, they had to make up Kanye's points. It wasn't like he wasn't scoring. He was.
Right.
And that's
right.
Where Zach Hicks has come in. DeMarco Dunn has come into the starting lineup. Jameel Brown off the bench. Even Cutis is getting more touches. So all of those things, somewhere you got to make up the scoring. They've made it up and then some. I feel badly because, it's not about Kanye the individual. It's just maybe about the circumstances that those two playing together. I think we all thought at the beginning, it's just fun, they're so quick, and they can do things, but the longer you looked at it, you know, the less comfortable you felt seeing it. Just didn't quite work.
Yeah, when Dick and I talk about it, it's not about the young man. It's not about his game. It's about the fit with what's needed to win, and maybe in this case, just from a basketball point of view, all the other stuff aside, right, from a basketball point of view, at the moment, this is the better fit.
Yeah, and I think, look, if Ace wasn't here, then Kanye probably would have been a lot more comfortable too.
Right.
Now, he doesn't see the court at this stage like Ace does. He's not as experienced. right, this is only his second year of college basketball, and he barely played last year, whereas this is Ace's fourth year, so he has that kind of experience. But, you know, we'll never know what might have happened, but he could go somewhere else where what he does fits what the coach wants to do exactly, and he could have a great couple of years. I hope
sure.
he does.
Right, exactly, and we hope he does too. There's no question about that. You mentioned Wahab in the middle. He's the one the one big guy they have that has a lot of experience, has played. And, you know, you didn't know what to expect going into the season, really, with any of these guys. Dick, what have we seen from him?
Yeah, it's fascinating, Steve, because we knew his game from the year at Maryland, and obviously we'd watched him play on TV at Georgetown.
Well, we saw him play in person at Georgetown, too. Remember
100%.
That?
Yeah. That's right, all the way back in 2020, four years ago. Actually, in 2019, November of 2019.
Yeah.
We saw him down in D.C. when Penn State ran Georgetown off the court. I frankly don't even remember him in that game or if he played or whatever, but he was at least on that team. And to me, he's been a revelation, and that's a credit to a couple of things. Obviously, you know, Q himself, he's worked at it, but major credit to Brent Scott, who works with the big guys.
Yep.
He's a changed player, Steve. He never was this effective at any of his other stops. Now, maybe it was going to happen anyway, but it's happened with this coaching staff. The game has slowed down for him. He won't do anything until he's ready to do it. He's shooting at a very high percentage because he'll only take high percentage shots. He doesn't do anything he can't do. He doesn't get into foul trouble, and they need him to not be in foul trouble because he's really one of one for them. I mean, they have some backups, but they're not of the same caliber or certainly don't have the experience as he has. So, yeah, he's been huge. And, you know, every once in a while, I think ahead a little bit. Obviously, we have some serious hoops to play the rest of the year, but you think ahead the next year, he's really going to be missed. And he's the one guy, you know, that's starting that can't come back. The rest of the group can come back, to be determined on who wants to come back. There's one more year of COVID. So, like, four-year players can have a fifth year.
Right.
I believe next year is it.
Yeah, I think it is, yeah.
There's no more of that. So Ace Baldwin can come back. Now, what Ace wants to do, whether he wants to go make some money professionally or he'd like to come back with NIL, you know, all to be determined. But Hugh will be a huge loss. I don't know enough about the young big guys they have coming in, but that'll be a big spot to fill for next year. But that's all fun to talk about over the summer and next fall. But right now, Hugh has been great. He's been exactly what they need.
Right. Yeah, I'm with you. I couldn't comment at all on the new players coming in until I actually see them in person. My opinion, there are probably three teams Penn State really doesn't match up well with in this league. And let's see if my list and your list are the same. Mine would be Purdue, for obvious reason. Edie, by the way, says he's not coming back next year. All right. Okay.
Yay.
Make money.
and he could come back if he wanted.
Yes, he could. Michigan, Purdue, Michigan State, actually, and ironically, Illinois. Those are my three. Everybody else in this conference, I feel Penn State in one form or another matches up with. Is that fair?
It's fair to this point, Stephen. I agree with all those three, and that's what was so fascinating about the Illinois win last Wednesday. And was there a bit of a miraculous tone to it? Yeah, there was.
Sure.
But because they're so big and strong and rebound so well, that is tough. But the thing about Illinois, Steve, they can be scored on.
Yes.
Their defense is not a huge priority for them.
No.
I think Michigan State's defense is a little better, although I don't trust Michigan State's offense, as they proved again yesterday when they gave away a lead at home against Ohio State. But their offense against Penn State has been great because they got nobody to guard Hall and Purdue for the obvious reasons. I would say this about Purdue. I think they're, and I'm not sure if I'm having the number exactly right, 20 points better in Mackey than anywhere else.
Yeah.
It's a huge number.
Yeah.
Whatever that number is. I mean, Michigan was actually in the game with them most of the way yesterday.
Right, that's right.
At Michigan. There's no Mackey games in the NCAA. But that's for later. The other team I'll tell you that concerns me, and it's not just because of what happened last Saturday. Man, I watched Nebraska last night.
Ooh, I did
they
too.
They locked up Minnesota. I mean, when I saw it, we saw it in person last Saturday at Pinnacle, I'm thinking, all right, well, Penn State's tired. You know, this is just a bad team. and Jeff Settle said it on the broadcast, and he's right. They become a really good defensive team out of nowhere. We already knew they could score. So that concerns me a little bit, but I'd like to see it on a neutral court with Penn State having proper rest, which they didn't have in that game in Nebraska. It's been an awful week. So.
Right.
Sometimes you can't judge it, but yeah, that might be the other one that concerns me. But you know what? See if they can get to Thursday, which they're probably favored to do at the moment.
Right.
It looks like the critical game may turn out, if they can win tomorrow, then that's giant. They almost are locked into Thursday if they can win tomorrow. But if they can't, then it's probably may very well come down to the Maryland game two weeks from yesterday. If they can win that game. But it's weird. I was looking at some of the other teams' schedules trying to figure out who's beating who, and frankly, I don't even know anymore. A lot of these results are random. I mean, did anybody see Ohio State beating Purdue and at Michigan State on Success of Sunday?
Right. With an interim head coach.
Right. I mean, nobody saw that coming. It's just like, not. It's like, what? What just happened? So, yeah, I think. But, yeah, I don't disagree. I think the three teams you mentioned are probably the most difficult matchups. But wouldn't it be fun to see Illinois again at the Target Center and see if they could beat them five straight times in five different
arenas? I know. Amazing. And as for Nebraska, I watched a good portion of that game last night, and, Dick, I walked away with the same feeling. I said, man, their defense, like, maybe I undersold fatigue versus defense last Saturday, because, I mean, they took, Minnesota's been playing at a pretty high clip, scoring a lot of points, and they took them apart defensively.
Yeah, Minnesota was, they were not far from like a long winning streak. They blew a lead. They had a significant lead at Mackey against Purdue.
Yep.
They had a 20-point lead against Iowa at home. So they played well enough to win both those games they lost, and they've won all the rest of their games in recent weeks. So they were already, I'm talking Minnesota now, they were playing great going into that game.
Yeah.
And they were a non-event last night. They were no factor.
Right.
And they got an offense. It's not like they don't have an offense. They got guys that can score. So I was watching the game last night, obviously more to watch Minnesota because Penn State will be there Saturday night. And as I'm watching the game, I'm going, you know what? I'm not really learning anything because that's not at all how Penn State plays defense.
Right.
Arizona or Nebraska plays it way differently.
Yeah.
So it's not helping me figure out what's going to go on with Minnesota, but I was kind of like, I need to reevaluate as I'm watching this about at the very least about Nebraska. And it's also possible maybe Minnesota went in there, maybe they hit the wall, which everybody does at some point in this league during the year. It's just the way it is. Just so many games. So much travel, but yeah, they're certainly better than they played last night, or maybe just Nebraska's gotten that good.
You've covered games in Rec Hall before when they were playing there in the Big Ten. Now you get a chance on the broadcast side. You and I worked that game Wednesday in Rec Hall. Look, there are a lot of things that fell into place for them to win it, but what did you think of just the pure experience of what happened Wednesday night?
I thought it was great. I hope they do it again. You know, as many times the season as it's feasible. I mean, I know there are a number of other sports in there, and it's hard to turn around and put a basketball court. I mean, I understand all that. So I don't know what the athletic department can or can't do, or what the deal is with the Jordan Center, and how many times they have to play. And I don't know any of that stuff. But so I think it was great. I think people really love the experience, like they love the Palestra experience. And you know, obviously, I love to see games at the Palestra. But, man, I would think it's something that the students would really get behind. I think the fans would get behind it. And it's unlike the Jordan Center, which we know what the issues are. It's a little cavernous. It wasn't really built for basketball. This is a gym.
Yeah.
And people are right on top of the action. You feel like you're part of the game. So, yeah, I thought it was great. And, of course, it's literally in the middle of campus where the kids can walk out of their dorm and walk across the street and get into the place. So, yeah, I mean, I hope it happens, you know, regularly, whatever that is, whatever's feasible. And I know Mike Rhodes said when he took the job, and he said it ever since, we want to do things differently. This is the state university. It's in the middle of the state, but take the team And you can't do that with a football team. You're playing in Beaver Stadium. I mean, I get that. But go to Hershey. Go to Madison Square Garden like this year. Go to the Palestra. Go to Allentown, where we played a game against Drexel a couple of years ago. You know, take the program around the state, showcase it, and you know what else, Steve? Take it where the recruits are.
Yes.
And bring those recruits. I know they had a lot of recruits at the Palestra. Bring them along. Go, hey, this is how we play. This is the kind of experiences we can give you. All that stuff is there. It's there for the taking. And the cool thing, yeah, I mean, Philadelphia's 3 hours away. Pittsburgh's a couple hours away. You could get anywhere in the state here in a couple hours. It's the center county for a reason. You can get places. You're in the center of the state.
DJ, I will see you at the airport.
Steve, I look forward to it. And you'll love it when you come outside today because it will feel like it's, I don't know, May maybe?
Yeah, feels like May. And we'll have dinner with our good friend Sean Morris tonight.
Yes, we will. We will meet Sean in Carlville. What could be better?
Sounds great. Thanks, Dick.
See you in a couple hours. All right, Steve.
Dick Jerardi. We will come back more in a moment. John Griffin next half hour here on News Radio 1070 WKF.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Sponsored by Prudy Insurance. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, RV, motorcycle, whatever it may be. They'll try and save you money. Could be bundles. Anything along the way to make a big difference in your life. Because, look, you want to save money no matter what you do. But you also want to make sure you're fully covered. It's Purdy Insurance. Great people who happen to be terrific pros. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. John Griffin, I believe, is supposed to... Yep, there's John. Hello, John. How are you today?
Hey, Steve, I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing hanging in there. You know?
Yeah, good.
And sometimes
good.
That's all we can do, right, John?
That's right. This time of the year, we're all in the same boat. We're all in the same boat.
You get to this time of the year. Look, every game has singular importance for you. What are you looking for signs from your team that says, okay, when the tournament comes around, which is right around the corner, my team is playing some of its best basketball? What are some of those signs you're looking for?
Well, it's a loaded question there. Really, right now,
so
I'm looking for...
I didn't mean for it to be a loaded question.
Poise.
Yeah.
Poise is the number one thing I'm looking for right now. And what I mean by that is... at this point in the year, there at times throughout the course of some of these games that hold a lot of value, whether it's standings or the overall direction that your team is going, each possession can seemingly be a little bit more, I don't know, have a little more pressure attached to it than it actually does. And so what's really required is a literally singular possession by possession element of poise. And I'm really actually looking at that every moment with our team, because we have a group that's we're playing for something right now. We're playing for some seeding, potentially a home court opportunity in the playoffs, something this group hasn't experienced in the last few years. So this is a brand new situation for every single player in our locker room. And when you're playing in these type of tough games, 1 3-pointer to an inexperienced team can emotionally feel like a 12-pointer, and it's not. So we've really tried to really focus in on this element of poise, taking each possession on offense and defense for what it is, and then being very confident in what we do, whether it be defense or offense, whatever side of the ball. I'm looking for those two things, confidence and poise.
right. I've done games in my career where, based on personnel and on coach, it'll be end of game, and they'll call a timeout because, look, they want to make sure I's are dotted, T's are crossed. Okay. And then I've done games where, based on personnel and situation, coach won't call a timeout. Go ahead, play. Make them get on their heels, and let's make something happen. At this stage with this group, what are you more in tune with right now with your team at this point?
Well, for us, because, like I said, we're still in this stage of growth from inexperienced to more experienced, quite frankly. I'll have to read the body language. That's a big determining factor for me as I'm observing how they're reacting to 6-point swing or a tough shot or just general fatigue. But I'm more likely to call timeout and get us kind of resettled and get everyone's mind back to the moment and then get them back out on the floor. But there have been times I'll let the gym play out a little bit and see if they can, quote-unquote, figure it out. Most teams that are NCAA tournament quality teams are able to adjust without a timeout. But majority of those teams have experience in those moments that they can rely back on. So we're still in that growth process. And for now, I'm more concerned about, you know, their body language. Like I said, their poise, their minds, their confidence. And I'll make the decisions according to making sure that that doesn't dip.
It's also that time of the year. Well, you know, it's almost every time, but this time of the year right now, where the value of every possession, I don't care if there's 8 minutes to go in the first half or 8 minutes to go in the game, is so high. It's one thing that you know it. I mean, that's one of the great things about coaching, John. It's not what you know. It's what they end up knowing.
Right.
Right. Somehow, some way. Right. How important has that been, especially for some of the younger players, to really get a grasp of that possession with 10 minutes to go in the first half is as valuable as 10 minutes to go in the game?
Yeah, I mean, it's you know, people say winning is a habit and losing is a habit. They're habits. In our world, we talk about that pretty regularly, actually daily. You know, and how are you building your habits that are going to hopefully put you in position to have success and be on the winning side of things. But, you know, it's all habitual. So, you know, how you do one thing is how you do everything. What is your energy level? What is the what's your concentration level? Are we communicating? All the intangibles that are not scheme related, you got to make sure that box is checked. For us, that's something that is a work in progress, quite frankly. But, you know, from a scheme and situation standpoint, I was talking to Coach Flannery, who you know, Coach Flannery, this morning.
Yep.
And you know, that was just a reminder that he gave me. You got to make sure that you are focusing on more situational potential end of game things that might happen, that you just have to make sure that, you know, if you don't have a timeout, you know, you're down three, you need to get a three, and you as a coach may know what you're doing, but does your team, like you just said, know what they're doing? Because those situations arise in this moment, and you really want to give yourself, actually, you know, as a coach, you want to give your team the best opportunity for them to find success. So they have to be confident and comfortable in knowing what we're doing in those chaotic situations, which will arise. And as we head into March, this is where you have to be, you know, really sharp in those environments.
About an hour ago, I was talking with Jack Hamm, and he was asking me about, after we're done talking about football, he asked me about college basketball, and I was talking about the job that Houston has done this year, changing conferences, but their defense, I said, you and I talk all the time in football, how defense travels. Well, when you beat Army, they shot 29%, 20% from three. You out-rebounded in plus seven. What can you say about your defense in that win?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's ironic internally, because at St. Joe's last year, where I was the associate coach, we played Houston in Annapolis on Veterans Day.
Yeah.
And I got to see up close and personal an energy level unlike any other.
Yeah.
On that defensive side of the ball. So our team knows what Houston, I mean, we've actually watched Houston in our locker room here at Bucknell, and it's just a perspective, providing perspective. But for us, you know, we've really focused on the last 2 days after getting home from Holy Cross on controlling what we can control. What's our physicality levels? What are our energy and effort levels on the defensive side of things? Because we didn't make shots in the second half against Holy Cross. And if you watch that last 20 minutes, which, you know, we talk about all the time on the show, the support of Lewisburg, they see the body language dipped a little bit. We don't have time. It's only 20 minutes. You don't have time to dip. Like you just said, every possession is important. So we're not going to be a team, a program that will play with energy when we make shots and a lack thereof when we don't. And so just focusing on the fact that defense can be such a reliable pillar of our success. And I thought our guys did a really, really great job of carrying over the messaging to putting it in action.
Well, and I was going to say, what does that do for a film session to then emphasize the point you just talked about? You just went through that where, you know, the shooting was the shooting, but your defense carried the day. What does that do in a film session?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly helps you build confidence internally. Like, it really gives you, as a group and the players, it gives them a mentality of, like, we can do this without having to make every single shot. And that should, hopefully, that'll spur us a little bit more here going forward to take that up a notch. But, you know, when you practice something and you concentrate on it and you see a result that is one in which you've been working towards, it'll be something to build on. So that's something that we'll utilize, of course.
You got Loyola coming up next, and that'll be on the road. You beat them at home already. Look, facts are facts. They're struggling, and it's not that your team won't understand that, but you're the one that knows it's nothing when you start. So what are your points of emphasis? Do they become a faceless opponent? Is it Bucknell overcoming Bucknell? How do you approach that?
Yeah, I mean, all of the above. D, that was an answer that I use pretty regularly coming up in all my testing, high school and college, all of the above.
You and I
it's
took
a combination
the same
of
approach.
All what you just said. You know, it's a faceless opponent, but that's attached to, you know, being the best version of Bucknell basketball that we can be. And we also want to make sure that we respect Loyola. Loyola is an explosive offensive team. They've shown that actually in the last 5 to 7 games. And we have to make sure that from a preparation standpoint, we are ready to go. I mean, it's so similar to football. You got to know your opponent. You got to know their strengths and burst their weaknesses. And, you know, now's the time of the year where, again, we are focusing on being the best version of Bucknell basketball. But in being that best version, we have to prepare for our opponent. And we have to be so locked into our scouting report and their tendencies so that we can have a very confident first 4 minutes of the game.
Well, they've scored 70 or better in 3 of their last 4 to amplify your point. At this stage, give me a player, and that this may, I don't want it in any way, shape, or form to slight any other player on your roster at this point because they're all working hard. But is there somebody in the last month that's kind of kicked it up a notch for you that has really impressed you?
Well, they've all kind of kicked it up in different games. You know, when you lose 4 in a row, I think outside the locker room, there's a tendency to wonder if it's impacting the energy levels of your group. And just really happily, I could say that it hasn't. So we haven't achieved the results that this group has been working towards when you lose 4 in a row, but everyone's kind of stepping up when they need to. Jack Forrest has been our Iron Man. He's led the league in minutes throughout the entire season up to this point. And, you know, people are just heavily focusing on stopping him. And, you know, having Josh Bosco back has given us another scorer. So everyone's kind of stepped up throughout the course of the last 6 weeks. Noah Williamson is our starting sophomore center, and I think that his comfort level and confidence continues to grow. He's had a couple tough games, you know. So what happens is teams change their scouting reports and start to focus on you when they didn't before, and it's a new experience. And so he's starting to understand how to navigate that. And everyone's experiencing, seriously, real time, something different every game. So it's a growth. There's a growth mindset, a growth pattern. I think we're on the right trajectory right now, but, you know, this group continues to work hard, and I'm just really proud of their complete appetite for it. You know, like I said, this is the time of year where a team could start to atrophy a little bit because they're not achieving the results, and we're not in that mentality whatsoever.
Hey, you know what? You win, you're over 500 in conference. That works. Yeah,
one day at a time in Lewisburg, right. Steve. One day at a right. time. I appreciate right. you.
Yeah, I appreciate you, too. Next one. Hey, look forward to talking to you, John. Thank you.
All right, Steve.
John Griffin. All right, they get one more. They're up. They'll be a game over 500. They're 8-8 in the conference right now. BU's 8-8. Lehigh's 9-7. American's 9-7. Lafayette 10-6. And Colgate is shockingly 14-2. Who the heck did Colgate lose to? Who did they lose to? Well, they just lost to American by 2. Who's their other loss? Oh, Lafayette. You know the weird thing about that? Both those losses were in Hamilton. Yikes. All right, take a break. Todd's having a great day today. He hasn't had to say a word yet.
I just moved my microphone over for the first time today.
Well done. Back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Okay, great to have you with us on the show today. And, yeah. I know it, I think some of you may have seen it today, but the column by Peter King from Football Morning in America, he has decided that now is the time to no longer write the column. He says he's retiring, and he uses the asterisk because, quote, I truly don't know what the future holds for me. I probably will work at something, but as I write this, I have no idea what it will be. Maybe it will be something in the media world, just not Football Morning in America, knee Monday morning quarterback. He says four reasons. This is from Peter's column today on NBC Sports. It's time. And he says, as most of you know, I've mostly moved away from the day-to-day minutiae of covering the league. Coaching searches, free agency, lead up to the draft. It's important, obviously. Last year, I started noticing how much of it I simply didn't care about. I had to force myself to be interested in things other than training camps and the games. And that's no way to do this job. I mean, and that's, you know, remember, as somebody who has worked with Dick Jerardi for 20 years, you know, Dick wrote over 7,000 either columns or articles in his career. 7,000. I mean, do you know how many late nights that takes? Do you know how many early mornings that takes? Do you know how many thousands of miles it takes to do that kind of job? Over and over again. Now, that's not a complaint from anybody, but when you do it for over 40 years, right, it takes a lot to do that. He said, I thought about walking away after last season. I remember asking Andy Reid last year in his office after the Super Bowl win over Philadelphia, are you going to retire? His retort, are you? He said, I didn't know what to say because I'd been thinking about it. But I still like doing the work so much that I decided to come back for the year, pretty sure it would be my last. Right? His next question was, is that all there is? He says, and he says, don't mean to be so deep, as he writes. Many of you who know me understand I'm pretty shallow. That's not true. That's not true. I'm sorry. Peter, that may be self-deprecating, but it's not true. So, but I find myself wondering, am I meant to do one thing from the time I walk out of college until the day they put me in the ground? And who knows, I may find myself jonesing to something in the media when I'm bored in 3 months. But it's like when Atlanta writer Jeff Schultz retired in December and said, let me get bored, I want to know what that feels like. That resonated. I'll know I'll want to do something with my time eventually. I just don't know what it is. Then he writes, one other thing that's hard to understand if you're not me. Last year, my big boss at NBC, Sam Flood, suggested I cut the column back from the average of 10,500 words or so to 6,000 or so, and set a hard deadline of Sunday night so I would not work until 4 a.m. It sounded good at the time. Two or three legit days off during the week, then a shorter sprint to the finish line Sunday night, Monday morning. But as the season started, I pondered what to cut entirely and what to write shorter. And it felt like if I did, it wouldn't be the same column. And there's the part of me that just couldn't change. It's the way my brain works. Example, I've been reading some old stories of mine trying to figure out what I wanted to put in this column. And I read something about John Madden. He coached his last game at the age of 42. True. Last Wednesday morning, I woke up a little after three, thinking about John Madden at the age of 42, and as happens most night, I went to the bathroom. Instead of just going to the bathroom, I started thinking about that amazing Madden number. I took out my phone and to look up some of the coaches on Pro Football Reference and realized Andy Reid has coached 429 games since the age of 42. And so that became one of my numbers game items for my final column. I was a little excited about it. I could not go back to sleep. At 66, it's hard to fall back to sleep once you get up at night anyway. This is a big one. My family. This is Peter writing here. The sacrifices my wife Ann and my kids Lauren, Mary Beth, and their families have made for me to do this job at the highest level have been significant. To do this job well, you've got to have some selfishness in you. You've got to miss some time at home. Lots of it. I don't feel great about lots of those times, but I don't regret them either. To do the job well, he says, some things in your family do suffer. Also, all three male members of my family, dad, two brothers, died by the age of 64, which I did know that, before ever experiencing retirement, and my buddy Don Banks passed away at 57 in a Canton hotel. All of that matters. That's a lot. That's a lot. Peter, the guy that set the standard for me in terms of this kind of column in reading from my youth was Will McDonough of the Boston Globe. And Will did a lot of work with NBC and then a little bit with CBS. His son is Sean McDonough. And Will, with every Sunday, would put out a column, full page, Boston Globe, football, notes. And he, to me, set a standard. Peter King maintained that standard, and in my personal opinion, exceeded it because of the way he went about his job. If he were to write something critical, he did it in the right way, not the over-the-top hot take way. He did it the right way. It takes some thought to do it the right way. It takes intelligence to do it the right way. The hot take way doesn't take a lot of, doesn't take a massive amount of intelligence, in my opinion. But the ability to criticize and do it the right way takes intelligence. The ability to find that nugget that makes a difference. And the ability to have a column that when it's done, it makes you think. This guy every week made me think. It's a loss for the profession.